again. It's time to introduce our speakers one by one. Let me start with Mr. Thiru Kumaran, co-founder and CEO of XR Labs. He founded one of the leading AR/VR solution companies in the region called XRLabs.co. A mechanical engineer by academics, comes from India, and has been over the last 5 years delivering solutions worth close to $2 million for Fortune 500 companies under various verticals such as art, aviation, aerospace, automotive, defense, energy, manufacturing, and retail. Thiru says the last 5 years he has done pre-sales, he has done solution design, he has done project management, he has done talent development in the field of emerging technologies such as virtual film production, augmented reality, virtual reality, artificial intelligence, and Internet of Things. He's a keynote speaker. He has been participating in various forums and initiatives across the region in India and here. A young gun, young entrepreneur who has a lot to offer. Let's welcome Thiru.
So the agenda of this session is basically to lay out a couple of best practices when a vendor and a company is engaging together to create a virtual reality simulator. Now, the reason why we came up with this deck is that there's a lot of ways a VR simulator project could fail to reach its ROI and agendas. And those essentially affect the enterprise's vision towards AR and VR itself, because they don't see it just as a project failure. They see it as being let down with technology itself. But which is why we actually put together this deck, sort of something that both all the stakeholders can use, both the enterprise and the vendors who actually create virtual reality simulations to basically make a better simulator from day one. Basically, this session will touch upon the steps that one needs to go through when, before, after, during, and after building a simulator. Let's start with the first one. As the name says, understanding the need. First, the vendor and the stakeholder are supposed to map out why exactly are we building the simulator. Is it for a safety training? Is it for a process? Or is it for an equipment? Let's say, is it a crane or a forklift, etc.? Or is it because the actual training is very expensive? Or are you going to save consumables by doing this training? This core need needs to be identified as the number one step, because it literally affects every other decision that both the stakeholders will be taking in building a virtual reality simulator. And also, of course, we need to learn who are the trainee and trainer's profile, what is the education level, how good is their access to technology, and so on. Because we have seen experiences where people who are not even introduced to a smartphone are being expected to do a great job inside a VR simulation, right? It's not a wrong thing, but everything else around in your VR needs to be built with keeping that in mind, that your audience has not even been exposed to a smartphone in the first place, and so on. And third, and one of the most important thing, is to understand how the current process is done, because the current process of activity in an enterprise itself has been refined over years of improvement. So that is definitely a good place to start and use as a reference to move on. And moving ahead, and at a very early stage, a very important decision needs to be taken, which is arriving on the device or the platform for the entire simulation. This could be taken on based on how many concurrent users are required, and what is the kind of graphics that's required, what is the level of portability is required, is the enterprise going to be using it inside a training hall, or are they expecting people to carry around the simulator here and there? And budget for the hardware, that is a great factor, and is haptic required as well. We will be diving into these in the initial upcoming slides. And a couple of these things are actually interlinked. For example, the concurrent users and budget actually goes together. For example, if somebody wants about 10 people to be using VR at any point of time, but the budget doesn't support that, you cannot go for maybe a high-end VR device, but you need to go for an entry level, like a standalone device like Oculus Quest. So these are decisions that affect everything, right, from design to 3D to development, etc. So these are the things that needs to be taken out at the initial stage itself. And certain other decisions that need to be taken in the initial stage is, of course, what kind of level of detail are we going to go for? and not just in the visual quality, but also in the process. For example, the meta simulations where the user has to perform, like a torquing of a nut and bolt 100 times. Now, are we going to actually have him do the actual process in and out for every nut and bolt? No, because that simulation is not about whether the user can learn how to torque a nut, but it's actually about the larger process. So we might choose to actually leave out the details in such steps. Two, 3D assets, which is a very basic thing. Like, you need to know what kind of detail you're going to do in your 3D models. And fidelity. Fidelity is a very important point. What is fidelity? For example, let's say we are in a virtual room. Can we interact with every other object over there and expect it to behave like it would in real life? That is fidelity. For example, let's say this is like a table fan in a room. If the training was for, let's say, IT purpose or any other purpose, the fan need not be expected to be switched on when you press on the button in the virtual world. But whereas if it's a crime scene simulator, you need to know, when you press on the button, the fan should switch on. Otherwise, the trainee is going to infer that the fan has been damaged, and that is a clue as well. So fidelity is a very important point that many companies overlook when they're doing a virtual reality simulation. And NSFCO target device platform, we just touched upon that in the previous slide. And third, and one of the many major factor for the entire virtual simulation to be a success is the UX and UI. Why is it very important for a project? It's important because, compared to a web app or a mobile app, if you don't like the design, let's say in your Zomato app or Airbnb app, you're going to forget about it the moment you close the app, right? But a bad UX or a UI in a VR experience is going to remember that, because you will definitely remember places bad memory. And since VR is an experience, it's literally a bad experience we are having. So people are going to remember that for a long time. Also, when you're having this negative perception, people tend to actually affiliate this negativity to the technology itself rather than to just the device design. And that's why it's very important to actually crack your UX very good. And there's a couple of things that we, in our experience of building 100 plus experiences, have mapped out. For example, every experience in VR at the least would definitely need onboarding. Why? Because even though you're bringing in your hands and everything into VR, you're going to have a specific way that the world in the virtual reality behaves. For example, you'll be able to jump to places you teleport, or you'll be able to open things by just clicking at them instead of holding on to them, and so on. You would be defining these in your experience, but if you don't teach the user how to do these, he's going to be very confused in the actual scenario. And what would also happen is that if he underperforms, you wouldn't know whether he underperformed because he didn't learn the controls well, or if he didn't actually learn the content at all. So for you to differentiate this, a separate experience for onboarding is very much required. Two, design team. This is very important as well. There are two, or even mixed hybrid as well possible, design themes that is there. Called one is a science fiction design theme, and another one is a grounded. Science fiction, as the name suggests, are interfaces that you would see only in a VR world. But whereas the grounded design means it takes inspiration from the real world to the VR world as well. Science fiction UI are okay, in certain cases. But in 99% of the cases, we have seen grounded UI works best, because you can't train someone for an interface that is not there in the real life. It can't be too distant from the real life. For example, having inventory, instead of buttons coming up in 3D space, you could simply have like a bag around you. You can just keep things into it. Now, that is an example of a grounded UI compared to a science fiction based UI. And feedback. So whenever a person does something, they're going to expect feedback in the virtual world, because they are only operating with two of their senses, eye and ears. We need to make sure the feedback is given in these two senses. In the real world, when you're attaching something, you actually feel it's being attached. In the virtual world, except for haptic, you don't get that. So one way to give feedback is visual. For example, glowing, like you have to place things over here and you have done it right, etc., could be visually given. Whereas in audio as well, you can give feedback. It could be a 3D. It could be a 3D, like a sound, or basically, like a spatial sound as well. And of course, haptics, for you to understand how you can, are you feeling certain things in your hand? For example, in a torquing, you can feel literally the torque turning. And next is the 3D art pipeline. You need to map out the level of detail where you see what kind of detail are you going to work for this project. Things in far away can be of low detail. Things in close can be of good detail. And again, the level of realism that's required. Not all projects need to be cinematic quality. Certain projects can be, I've seen projects where even if it's cartoony, it still gets the training across. And pipeline, of course, it is one of the earliest decisions that needs to be taken, where you choose, okay, what device are we attaching? So what kind of pipeline the entire project should go through? It's a very technical must-have to be done in the initial stages. And functionality development, the core development job, right? So we have seen that in many projects, we actually allocate a separate resource just for interface development, because only that will allow you to iterate, in case your UI turns out to be bad or functional isn't good. You actually go ahead and, have one person just for iterating the designs. Two subsystems like inventory and the tool functionalities need to be again having a separate resources to work on. And then again comes integration. What all integration is required? Are we supposed to integrate with the dashboard or a hardware and so on? And finally, the last slide, risk factors. In any simulation project, you're going to have multiple risk factors like turnaround time. For enterprise companies, they have a lot to do. So whatever you submit as review need to be very detailed as such, so they can give you that review in a very quick manner. Two, dependency on SOPs and 3D files. Getting enterprise clients to share their most guarded assets. We have many cases where clients have shared the 3D model for the first time in their lifetime with us when they created the simulation. So it's very tricky and very time-taking process. And the dynamic hardware system, every few quarters you get a new hardware. It's really important that you choose a hardware that's scalable. And for lack of design guidelines, as I mentioned, a lot of UX and UI need to be iterated and so on. You don't have much of a guideline to depend on. Change management, unless you don't do your code modular, which also attaches to the next point. If you don't do the code modular, you're going to be suffering a lot when there's every change is coming up in the entire project. So this is a quick run up into what best practices to follow when you're building a virtual reality simulation. You could be a client, you could be a vendor. I hope this video was helpful for that. Thank you.
So Thiru, one more question. As per your experience and expertise and know-how, for the XR landscape, for the XR industry as such, what would drive it? Entertainment or enterprise?
I think at least during COVID and from now on, and in the new normal, I think it's going to be both equally, because you can see the huge revolution that's happening in the virtual production and virtual game development right from wherever you are, right? So entertainment also is now really heating up for XR, and enterprise will always be the one of the core and dependable market. In entertainment, you might have to put in a year's effort and the output might not be a hit. For every Beat Saber, there has been 10 other titles that has failed.
Yeah.
Right? But an enterprise, as long as you solve the problem, it's going to work. You're going to have a good share of the market as long as you have a good product out there.
Thank you for the answer. Thank you once again for that. And thank you for coming. Thanks a lot for taking time out from a busy schedule and participating in VR AR MENA Summit. Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye.